Janjanachalakaya Chakshurur Militam Jena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadhamayam Tadati Swapadantikam Pandeham Shri Gurav Shri Jyota Patakamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitham Tham Sajivam Sahvetam Sahadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhamvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namaskate Bhakta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Svedevi Pranamani Hariye Vamsha Kalpatarubhyascha Vrasindubhyayavacha Patithanam Bhavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Krishna Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Prachadine Nirvishesha Sunyavadi Ashrata Deshakadine
for a lecture filled with wisdom and history. My special gratitude to His Holiness Indrajula Swami Maharaj for leading the whole world with mercy. His Holiness Devamrita Maharaj was narrating from Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita with incredible reflections of the meaning of the story of the Chidagahi Utsav, which is the festival we are celebrating today. Maharaj was speaking how Raghunath Das Goswami was coming from a family which was practically equivalent to billionaires today. But in certain ways more, because they weren't depending on competitive business. They were practically landowners. It was almost like a country. And they could rule, and whatever they said was, no one could take it away. Raghunathas was the sole heir of the entire family. There was only one child in the whole next generation. The father and uncle were getting older. They were preparing everything to give to him. And Maharaj explained the difference between spiritual wealth and material wealth. In material wealth, whatever we get, there's always the challenge, because inevitably it will all be taken away. Maybe today, but for certain in the near future. And however much we have, we can never be satisfied. For a simple philosophical understanding, anandamayogyasha, the living force, the soul within all of us, is a part of Krishna, an eternal servant of Krishna. Jivarasvarupoi Krishnaranityas. This is the basis of transcendental knowledge, to understand who I am. As an eternal servant of Krishna, our nature, eternally, is to serve with love, because that's the nature of love, is to serve. The first day I came to Vrindavan 52 years ago, somebody told me, bhakti means to serve. I was thinking that very interesting, because living in Himalayas, that was not so much the discussion. It's to be, not to serve. But to serve is the very essence of our being. Because when there's love, there's the unconditional, unmotivated desire to serve. Sanatan Dharma. That is the eternal nature of the soul. Because to the degree we experience the infinite love of Krishna, of God, we want to reciprocate with gratitude and with service to please our beloved. And eternal means ever increasing in the spiritual sense. And the path of bhakti, eternal, isn't just, it lasts forever. When it's built on the foundation of prema, or love, it's increasing forever. Krishna's infinite, inconceivable, achintya. His love is ever increasing for every living being who reciprocates. It's actually for everyone, but we recognize it when we reciprocate. So as Krishna's love is ever increasing for us, we have the power by Krishna to have ever expanding, increasing love for Krishna for eternity. That's a much deeper experience than being at peace. Being at peace means there's no disturbances. But in love, we actually welcome disturbances, because it only increases our desire to serve. Prema Pumartha Maha. This is Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's teaching, that the crest jewel, the purushartha siromana, the highest perfection of yoga, religion, and life itself, is unconditional, unmotivated love for God. And when that love is awakened from within, and serving Krishna and loving Krishna like watering the root of the tree, it extends to every living being and everything, because everything is emanating from Krishna. Janmatyasa yada Brahma Sutra tells. It's the first aphorism. Who is God? What is the absolute truth? From whom everything emanates. The root of all of existence. The origin of all. And the ultimate goal of all. Om Purnam Adha Purnam Idam. Who is everything is included in Krishna. And everyone. So material wealth. Material fame, material power, material health, anything material. It's temporary and it's limited. But the soul is thirsting for a love, a pleasure, ananda, that is eternal and unlimited. And because life itself is dynamic, the love we're seeking is not static. Or stagnant. It's dynamic. It's ever increasing. Nothing in this world is ever increasing. So it's very hard to conceive of it. And if we think that we've conceived of it, that means we really have no idea what it really is. But it gives us an understanding we could strive for as the purpose and the goal of our life, in which every decision and everything we do and everything we say is in harmony with making progress toward that goal. That is bhakti. So here is Raghunathas, as Devamrita Swami Maharaj described. He has everything. He has fame. He's really in good health and he's extremely good looking, as they say. He's famous. He's loved and he's popular by everybody because he's just such a good person. He's living in a palace. Indrajuna Maharaj, have you gone to his birthplace, Krishnapur, in Saptagram? It's still there today, you can see. In fact, his shoes are there. You probably have some piece of it somewhere. He had everything and more that we could conceive. Maharaj described when he was just a little boy, his parents, who were pious and religious, brought him to see Haridas Thakur, who was actually, he was persecuted. He was considered by many to be an outcast just because of the way he was born. He had absolutely no money. He had no property. He would travel around and live in caves or jungles. He just wore a kalpan, which is just like a little loincloth. But he was always chanting Krishna's holy names, Radha's holy names. And the happiness he was getting through the love he was experiencing and chanting God's names, Raghunath saw that. That is what I want. That is the wealth of the soul. That is the actual prosperity of the heart. And he wanted to go away. But as Maharaj was saying, he couldn't. Because nobody wanted him to go except nobody in his family. So when he came to Panihati,
He saw Lord
Nityananda,
who is the Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda Paramakaruna Pahunduvi Janani Thai Gaurachandra. They are supremely merciful because they are giving the highest benediction of the most inclusive and sweetest form of eternal love for God to anyone who's willing to receive by following some simple principles. Nityananda Prabhu, actually Panihati, it's a village on the bank of the Ganges in Bengal. Our beloved Guru Maharaj Srila Prabhupada, he wanted to have land in a center in Panihati for people from all over the world to come and understand the significance of this pastime in this place. And after many years, his loving, devoted servant, His Holiness Bhakti Charu Swami Maharaj, he got land in Panihati, built a temple, an ashram, a guest house. And some years ago, I was in Calcutta, we were giving talks together, and he said, I want to take you to Panihati. I said, please. So he took me to the Ganges in Calcutta, and he had a boat there. And he brought a few devotees to have kirtan, and we actually rode on a boat from the docks of Calcutta, close to where Srila Prabhupada boarded Jaladutta, and we drove, we flowed upstream, or downstream to Panihati. And that was beyond any heavenly experience I could ever hope for. Sailing in the middle of the wide river Ganga, Ganges, sitting side by side with Bhakti Charya Swami Maharaj, hearing him tell me stories of the histories. Breeze of Mother Ganga, invigorating the experience, and it's a beautiful project. Please go. So Nityananda Prabhu was in Panihati. That was actually his base for reaching out to all sorts of people without discrimination of who they were, what they did, where they were from. And after I tell one story, I'd like to how he got there. That's a beautiful story. So he's sitting under a beautiful banyan tree, and that banyan tree is still there today on the bank of the Ganges on a platform. And Radhanath got permission from his family, along with about 12 guards, who were his assistants, to visit Lord Nityananda in Panihati. And here is Raghunath Das. So much wealth, so much fame, so much power. And he's seeing these simple devotees along with Lord Nityananda under this tree. He was so humbled by the wealth they possessed. He felt himself to be so worthless without that spiritual wealth. From a distance, he bowed down. He was really shy to come forward. For real. One of Lord Nityananda's associates said, there is Raghunath. And Nityananda called out, Raghunath, you are a thief. Only a
come here.
And Raghunath was actually too shy to come, so Nityananda came to him and placed his feet on Raghunath's head. He said, because you are behaving like a thief, I am going to punish you. Now I'd like to discuss very briefly the meaning of this punishment. Because if a billionaire is to be punished, do you ask for $1 fine? You know, judge is going to, you know, what hurts? So here is such a wealthy man, and Nityananda Prabhu wanted to give a lesson to the whole world. He said, I want you to feed all these devotees and people here with chitta and dahi. Chitta is the cheapest food in India. How many of you have gone begging house door to door in India? Please raise your hand. Person is proud of being a beggar. Us. We're boasting about being beggars. Chitta is flat, dry rice. And when you go begging, usually when you go to a house, they refuse you. But if they're going to give you something, they usually give you the cheapest thing they have, which is chitta, flat rice, because it costs practically nothing. And it's really dry. Usually you have to put moisture in it and do something with it. They just put a handful of chitta. Lord Nityananda, the penalty for Raghunath, not make a feast of samosas and rasgullas, make a feast of chitta, the cheapest food, and serve to everyone with dahi, yogurt. Because the value of something, and this is a very important lesson here, the value of something is the devotion, the love, and the sincerity is which it's offered. Srila Prabhupada said, if you don't have much money, if you offer to the deities a garland or a necklace made out of simple glass, to Krishna is more precious than the best diamonds and the crown of the king of England. Because the value is in the love and the devotion and the sincerity in which it's offered. And because we have our whole value system contradictory to the truth in this world, there's so much fighting and so much quarrel and so much depression and envy and arrogance and dissatisfaction. Because we don't understand what's valuable to the heart and the soul. Our value system is based on what we impose values according to our ahankar, our false ego, our misconception. So Raghunath That was the order he was given. He and his assistants, they got all the chitty in the neighborhood, chitta in the neighborhood, and the yogurt, and they started getting everything else they could get and started feeding and feeding. And I don't want to repeat the story Maharaj already spoke, but it was such a wonderful feast. They soaked all the chitta half, they soaked all of it in hot milk first, and then half was put with yogurt, sweetener, and bananas. And the other half was condensed milk, sweetener, a special banana that's very special, and ghee and camphor. And everybody got two pots with each one. And it was so good, and it was offered with so much devotion and so much enthusiasm that more and more people started coming. The word spread. The platform filled up. The base beside the platform filled up. The whole bank of the Ganges filled up. There were so many people, there was no space anymore. They were standing in the Ganges with their two little pots of chitta and thai. And Lord Nityananda was so happy. He called in his meditation for Lord Chaitanya to personally come and be part of this festival, because he knew how pleased Lord Chaitanya would be with the devotion of Raghunath Das Goswami. The next day, that night they had big kirtan in the house of Raghava Pandit, a great devotee. And the next morning, when Raghunath Das Goswami went to Nityananda Prabhu, he begged for his mercy that he could completely take shelter of the service of Lord Chaitanya. Nityananda Prabhu said, because you made Lord Chaitanya so happy by making all these devotees and all these people so happy, you will be blessed not only with the shelter of the Lord, but you will be an intimate, internal associate of Lord Chaitanya under the guidance of his dearmost devotee, Swarup Damodar Goswami. And then Nityananda Prabhu told all the devotees, please give your blessings to Raghunath Das. Raghunath Das went to every single person there, bowed to them. In genuine and sincere humility, took dust from their feet and put on his head in a sincere expression that I want to serve you. When you have that attitude, you don't have to ask for blessings. Blessings just flow from saintly people. They all picked him up and embraced him. Raghunath Das Goswami said to Lord Nityananda that no one can approach God, Lord Chaitanya, directly. It's impossible. Not when we're in a conditioned state. Nityananda Prabhu represents the principle of guru. One who is an instrument of the Lord's grace. Through wisdom, through instruction, through example, and through giving us a lifestyle to live. Raghunath had everything, but he's coming before Nityananda. He said, without your mercy, no one can approach the Lord and find real shelter. And Lord Nityananda, how did he give mercy? He didn't say, serve me. He said, serve those I love. And he gave Raghunath a service. Of course, Raghunath elaborated on it by his own, but he gave him a service any of us could do. Chitta, chit rice. Patram pushpam palam toyam. Krishna says, if you don't have anything else, if you offer with love and devotion a leaf, a flower, a fruit, or water, not only will I accept it, I will be conquered by your devotion. The proprietor of all wealth becomes subordinate to the love of the devotee. The controller of all controllers wants to be controlled by love. And a devotee wants to be controlled by the Lord's love. In this material world, people really want to be controllers. In the spiritual world, everyone wants to be controlled by love. Even God. And Srila Prabhupada gave the example, love me, love my dog, is a saying in the West. And it's really true for many that if you want to love me, you have to love who I love. That's the best expression of love. Not bhakta puja yadika. Krishna says, worship of those who love me is more dear to me than worshiping me. Our beloved Guru, Srila Prabhupada, we could do so much for him, but if we were truly trying to uplift and enlighten those he loved, the devotees, and the people of the world, that's what pleased him the most. One particular devotee was one of Srila Prabhupada's personal servants, assistants, traveling around the world, and Srila Prabhupada sent him to this strange land to give Krishna consciousness, bhakti to others. And there's a beautiful recording I just listened to not maybe a week ago where Srila Prabhupada's explained. He was thinking I was rejecting him. But actually, I was giving him a more important service that's more dear to me. To share the love that I'm trying to give with the world. Such an important lesson. Raghunath Das Goswami, within our lineage, parampara, he's the Prayojana Acharya. That means he is the guru for all time to come, who is teaching by his example the highest principles of the most intimate ecstatic love of God, the love of the gopis of Vrindavan, as Devamrita Maharaj is describing so beautifully. How did he approach that? Through being the servant of the servant of the servant. And although he did it with all of his heart the best he could, the basis of the service was so simple anyone could do it. It's not exclusive for any particular social status or nationality or anything else that we may have. Because bhakti is based on the sincerity of our hearts and souls to serve, to please, to love. How how did Lord Nityananda...
And soon after that, Raghunath Das Goswami became the very crest jewel of expressions of pure love of God in the highest spirit of renunciation. Previous to this, Lord Chaitanya was living in Jagannath Puri. From Navadvip, he took sannyasa and came to Puri. And every year, devotees would come to spend about 4 months with him from all different regions. And Nityananda Prabhu, one day in a solitary place, Lord Chaitanya told him, "You should go to Bengal because I'm here. I want you to launch the chanting of the holy names of the Lord in such a way that love for Krishna, love for Radha Govinda is accessible to everyone. Don't consider who's fit or unfit. Offer this highest perfection to all. Because in this age of Kali, no one's really fit." So Nityananda Prabhu, he left Puri with some wonderful associates. And Param Vijayate Sri Krishna Sankirtan, the highest benediction for all humanity, is this congregational chanting of the holy names. Because this Maha Mantra, these holy names, and soon Indrajumana Maharaj, as soon as I get out of the way, he's going to speak and lead us in a kirtan where you'll understand what Nityananda Prabhu's mercy really is. Krishna has descended, go look at a Premadana Harinam Sankirtan, from the highest realm of the spiritual world. This sound vibration of the mantra of the holy name has descended. Kavi Kalem Namurupe Krishna Avatar. In this age, God's name is the incarnation that will cleanse our hearts and restore beyond liberation love of God. So Nityananda Prabhu and his associates, they started. It takes a couple weeks to walk from Jagannath Puri to Bengal. They started kirtan, and they were going down the road. And they were so absorbed. Lord Nityananda, when he would gaze at you with compassion, you could taste the holy names and you would be beyond this world. And that's what happened. What happens when you're beyond the world and you're trying to get somewhere in this world? They were taking the path along the, toward the Ganges in Bengal. They were on the road. And they were singing and dancing. One devotee, Ramdas Abhi Ramdas, he was absorbed in such a state of love for Krishna. He just, he went into a trance and stood like he was playing a flute. And everybody just chanted around him because he couldn't move for 9 hours. And they started going again. It's not that they were saying, "Hurry up, what are you doing?" They were all beside themselves. And after many, many hours, they asked somebody, "Where is the road to the Ganges?" "Huh? You're going the opposite direction. It's back 6 hours." So they went back to the road. And then they're chanting and dancing again, and they did it on the way. And after a while, they asked somebody, "Where is the road to the Ganges?" And they said, "Huh? it's 20 hours the other way. And they kept doing like this. And somehow or other, nobody knew how. I can't explain. You can't understand. They didn't even know. They arrived at the bank of the country. And where did they arrive? In Panihati. And there was a great, there were two great devotees living there on the bank of the Ganges, Raghava Pandit and Damayanti. They were brother and sister. They were famous for cooking. The scripture tells that whenever Damayanti and Raghava Pandit cooked together, Srimati Radharani would personally cook through them in the kitchen. And Durvasa Muni gave Radharani a benediction in a pastime that whatever she would cook would taste sweeter than nectar. And that anyone who tastes that food will not only be intoxicated by the flavor, but will have strong, will become strong and healthy. So Nityananda Prabhu, they arrived at his house on the bank of the Ganges. And Nityananda Prabhu at that moment wanted to start the Sankirtan movement for everybody, everywhere. And he glanced at all of his devotees and they started singing. What a kirtan. I'm going to just tell a few things, then we'll have kirtan. While they were chanting, Nityananda Prabhu's glance was so filled with compassion that anyone he looked at would fall to the ground in ecstasy. And he looked across the courtyard like this, and every person there was going like, they'd all stand up and he'd look this way and they'd go it may seem impossible to you, but if we look at the miracle of creation, the inconceivable nature of everything from the atomic particle to the universe itself, it's beyond comprehension. If the creator of all this can do things that are unbelievable, then what to speak of when he wants to express his spiritual love for someone? It's not within the confines of what we experience as possible. So these stories are just giving us a glimpse in the power of compassion. They were chanting and he began dancing with them. He had kirtan leader Madhava Ghosh, Vasudev Ghosh, and Govinda Ghosh. When they sang, Vrindavan manifested. And they became so beyond this world. Some devotees, they literally danced. They danced up a big tree. And they didn't consider where they were or what was happening. They were dancing, and they were grown people too. They were dancing across the branches, to the twigs. They were dancing on the leaves of the tree. And they didn't fall. Because in their love of God, they were just beyond what's possible or impossible in this world. And some of them jump from the tops of the tree. I'm a copper boy. See what I could do. And they jumped, dancing. And others, they embraced huge trees while they were dancing. And the tree became like a dancing partner. Came out of the ground and danced. How heavy is a tree? This kirtan went on like this 3 months. One kirtan.
No one drank a drop of water. No one ate a morsel of food. No one closed their eyes to sleep. How is that possible? They transcended in their love of God. And it's not that people were saying, I'm tired, when will the kirtan end? I'm hungry, when will the feast come? They were tasting the namamrita, the nectar of the holy days. And after 3 months, they had a really good feast. And then there was, Nityananda was taking them one by one to people's homes. And there were some really small children, 5, 6, 7 years old, and Nityananda Prabhu glanced at them. And they, for 1 month, they were singing and dancing and with trees in their arms, taking them out of the ground. They didn't eat or sleep. And their parents, seeing their children like this, it's not that they were saying, please come home. They were so happy. Nityananda Prabhu was giving such love of God, perfection of life to them. And this is a little sample of how Nityananda Prabhu and his associates, through their own taste and enthusiasm to chant the holy names, and through their pure compassion to give real liberation and real prema, real love to everyone who would accept it. That was the beginning of Nityananda Prabhu's outreach with Sankirtan. And it took place in Panihati, that place where Bhakti Charu Swami is inviting us to find the shelter of Nityananda's mercy. And it was that, why did Srila Prabhupada want to center there? Because that's the mood, the spirit of compassion that has been handed down through our lineage, our parampara, through the centuries. Srila Prabhupada not only went house to house, but he went country to country, continent to continent, to give us that same gift. I'm sorry if I went over time, but I got this idea of chitta makes me really kind of crazy. I love chitta. One of the best parts of chitta is it never spoils, because it's so dry. So sadhus, they beg for chitta, and you get like usually a cloth or a gumsha, and people put it in, and then you tie it up, and then you go into the wilderness, go into the Himalayan jungles, or go to a cave, and you don't, for months, you just find a little water and put it in a little chitta and you eat some and you can survive forever. Well, not forever, but a long time. But the kind of chitta festival that we're having today